and show him what he wants us to pray for. You know, I don't know if you come in with my list, although I may bring them up from time to time. But when I go to God, show me how you want me to pray. God, what is your vision? What is your heart? What do you want me to pray about? Now, if we get in the middle of what he's doing and we're following his vision and his heart, our progress is going to be so much faster than us trying to get him to get us to come help what we're doing, okay?
That's right.
So a fresh young voice cut through the selfish unbelief of a tired remnant. Haggai is prophesying to the remnant. We have been all year on Ezra and Nehemiah on the Tuesday morning Bible study, which is about the remnant coming out of Babylon and God protecting the messianic seed, that out of this holy remnant there would come forth Jesus Christ, the Messiah. And he kept this remnant pure. But the remnant had become selfish, doing their own thing, worried about their own prosperity, and they were in unbelief. So Haggai tells them, consider your ways. God's message came literally by the hand of Haggai. The word of the Lord began to flow through his servant like a mighty river. Over 500 years before the birth of Jesus, the voice of this young prophet pierces the iron allegiance of a people determined to preserve their lukewarm lifestyle. Does that sound anything like the church today?
Yes, it does.
The word of God is living, and it is for every generation. And we know that we are the remnant, and we know that we have been shaken, and we know that God has been bringing us forth to take us in someplace. But in the midst of that shaking, a lot of us had gotten lukewarm. Me, mm-hmm. Well, I wasn't lukewarm with God. I think I still had my fire, but I was getting comfortable. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It was, you know, I knew how to do this thing. Not anymore. The living word is postured and focused to revive the original vision of God. The original vision of God. We talk about the original intent of our founding fathers for our nation, and that's where we want to stay because it's worked really well for over 200 years.
Come on, man.
And our God has an original vision, and that vision will not be changed. It will be sovereign, and that which God purposes as his original vision will come to pass. I want to be in that. That's what I want to be in with my life. He's called the prophet 5 times in this book. Prophet means an inspired man to speak or seen by inspiration. The earliest use describes someone who becomes God's mouthpiece under the influence of the divine spirit. A prophet is one who sees into the supernatural realm and are hearers in the supernatural realm, and then speaks for God to men. You've heard me speak of the difference between an intercessor and a prophet. An intercessor cries out to God from the earth. They cry out for the people to God from the earth. And that a prophet sits in the council of God and says, thus saith the Lord.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. I've told y'all this story of this lady that I used to know, and she was a powerful intercessor, and she would pray and ask God to rearrange everything and come down here, and we'd be praying together in tongues, and then I'd say, well, God said this, and she says, but that's not what I want him to do. And I said, but God says this. So, but the prophet will hear what God is saying.
Amen.
And the earth needs to come into agreement
yes.
with God.
Yes. Amen.
Instead of asking him to rearrange things according to their understanding. Haggai addresses Zerubbabel, the heir apparent of David, and Joshua, the son of the high priest, a holy minister and a descendant of righteous Zadok. We have studied all of this line upon line in Ezra, in the book of Ezra. Together, Zerubbabel and Joshua prefigure the Lord Jesus Christ, the true King Priest, who by his resurrection raised up the true temple by his body. These two men also signal the first fruits remnants to be kings and priests, foreshadowing the New Testament priesthood after the order of Melchizedek. Now, as we have gone through this journey the last 2 years, as we know that God was shaking us out for something to take us into something, one of the things that has come forth is this authority that has been given to the church to take our authority to rule and reign with Christ, and to move into those offices of the King Priest ministry that he's calling for the people to stand in that authority. Haggai's prophecy has to do with unshakable peace, unbreakable relationships, unbroken covenants, and undivided hearts. Last week we had Brother McManus, which was a tremendous, powerful service. I mean, it was powerful. And there were those of you who were here who probably got a supernatural deliverance when he prayed for you, as well as when he was preaching, you received a deliverance just from the preaching of his word in the realm of the soul as well as the flesh. And if your soul gets healed, your flesh gets healed.
That's right. That's true.
If your soul gets healed, your flesh gets healed. And he brought forth a tremendous message in his book. I still haven't sat down with his book, but I know it's the healing of the soul. He called it the salvation of the soul, which is the same thing. To get to the place where if you have pain in your soul, that God didn't put that pain there. That pain came from the devil or your own flesh. And you can be delivered from the pain of your soul and live in a pain-free zone in the Spirit of God on earth. Amen. And that's what he was bringing to us in power last week. Jesus is the source of unwavering peace. Haggai speaks to our generation concerning the restoration of God's house and the glorious one who lives there. Zion, the kingdom of God, will never be moved. Ever. The Zion that is in you and I is the same Zion that was in Jesus Christ. It's the same Zion that is in God, who created heaven and earth and who created you and I. And it will never be moved.
Come on, the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow.
And that power of God that rests in you and I, that creative power of God, that healing power of God that rests in you and I, is still there and it cannot be moved.
Hallelujah.
We're just living below what God has called us.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Haggai encouraged the remnant in their distress. That's what we're supposed to do, you know. If you come to me and you're troubled or you're in pain, it's not my job to scold you for being in trouble or being in pain.
Amen.
It is to help you come out of your pain. Troubled people are troubled. You know, you get. That's one of the first, ministry 101. Pain, people who have pain in their heart cause pain. Ministry 101. You don't shun those people, you help them in their distress. He predicts that the New Testament temple would exceed Solomon's in magnificence. Because the silver and the gold belong to Jehovah. We're probably going to get into that next week about the silver and gold belonging to Jehovah. That's going to preach real good. Haggai jogs the remnant's memory, recounting the panoramic description of God's delivering power from the tyranny of Pharaoh. So he says, remember the Passover. Almost a millennium had passed since the establishment of the Mosaic Covenant. Generations have come and gone, but Jehovah's word remains unchanged.
Amen.
Everything that is written in this book is yours.
Yes.
Just like it's written. There may be a condition to meet, but you meet the condition, step up and claim the promise.
Amen.
And everything
yes.
that is in this
yes,
word
Lord.
Is yours.
Yes,
thank
Lord.
You so.
And the power of this word is yours.
Amen.
And who God says he is, he is.
Amen.
Good
word.
Deuteronomy 6:23. And he brought us out from thence that he might bring us in. Did God bring us out of something?
Yes.
Do I have a witness on this? Have you been brought out of something?
Yes.
Amen. In the last few years. Mm-hmm. Okay, so if the Spirit of God moved sovereignly and overturned everything and brought us out of our comfort zone, what's he going to do with us? He's going to take us in.
Woo! Come on, man.
Yes,
Lord.
Thank you.
That's just the way God works.
That's right.
Yes, amen.
Woo!
Hallelujah.
Moses brought them out. Joshua brought them in. God calls his people out by the hand of a shepherd that he might bring them in by the word of a soldier. Our heart must be reassured that his spirit is still in covenant with us and with what he has called us to do. Who God has called you to be, and what the call that he has on his life, you will become it. You will do it in spite of yourself.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
You can sit on a bar stool if you're a prophet and prophesy.
Yes.
You can be living in sin, but that gift that God has placed in you is still going to come out of you.
Yes.
Now, if you don't begin to use it for Jesus, he may take you out at an early age.
Yes. That's right. It's true.
Every true leader must fearlessly declare these things by precept and lifestyle if God's people are to have hope. We have to declare it. Joanne, that's kind of what happens at a Thursday evening. I got up and declared it.
Yes.
Amen.
And we must fearlessly declare it, no matter who we're standing in front of.
That's right.
Amen. Praise God.
And Haggai was faithful to his generation. Oh, God has raised up prophets. Oh, my goodness. The prophetic was restored to the church, and what a blessing that has been. And I was in a church before it was restored back, and it was just the greatest blessing in the world to have the prophetic restored. But how many of these prophets who have the prophets have been faithful to their generation?
Mm.
Or have they been faithful to their gifts and callings and to their own name and fame? Haggai 2:5. According to the word that I covenanted with you, when you came out of Egypt, so my spirit remains among you. Do not. Every covenant in this Bible belongs to us. It came to us through the cross and through Jesus Christ. The word Passover was brought into Pharaoh's court by the king priest ministry of Moses and Aaron. Then confirmed the signs and wonders and miracles. Now we all want to be kings and priests. But when God begins to move to you by his spirit in that anointing, there's going to be signs and wonders and miracles that are going to be following you.
That's right.
Its essence was, let my people go.
Amen.
Passover is a vast subject, and we've taught on it many times, and I've got a teaching on Passover on the website. But today I'm going to talk about it, that it's related in threes. God does everything in threes, if you haven't noticed. If you got trouble coming to your house, it usually comes in threes.
Mm-hmm.
If God moves in great blessings, they usually come in threes.
Thank you, Lord.
The first is the Passover of salvation, which is in Exodus. The Passover of conquest, which was Joshua. And the Passover of kingdom, which is the kingdom of God, is in Luke 22. Our walk began with the blood of the Lamb. Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us.
Yes, yes, Lord.
His precious blood has brought the forgiveness of sins. This experience marks the beginning of months for the believer. Subsequently, we receive the power of God in our Pentecostal baptism. The heavenlies, like Canaan, opened to us in the Passover conquest. Our hearts were circumcised and the reproach of the world rolled away at Gilgal. Our diet changed from manna to corn. And we encouraged a new dimension of spiritual warfare. We encountered a new dimension of spiritual warfare. There was a time in your walk when you prayed out to God and you cried out to God in prayer. And that's good. And then there was a time one day when you started praying and you was no longer just crying out to God in prayer. Suddenly the word of God became spiritual warfare and you began to pray in warfare.
Amen.
You will move into that realm.
Yes.
Where you will move into a new dimension of spiritual warfare. The captain of our salvation has come to bring down every wall. Ultimately, God's people will pass over into another age. And I'm talking about on this side of the grave.
Amen. Come on.
A nation will be born in a day, and the net wealth of the nations will come into the church. Sin and Satan will be cut off completely, and men will be freed from the bondage of futility and corruption, and God's people are gloriously delivered. That is who you are.
Amen.
That's who the church is.
Yes.
He has brought us out, folks.
Yes.
From where we were to take us in.
Yes, Lord.
He's taken us into the place where the word of God becomes such an authority with us that when we speak it and proclaim it, in my mind, I think what I think comes to happen. And I have to be careful what I'm thinking on. I can't be going thinking over here on this when I'm trying to do this. Because what I'm thinking is what I'm beginning to produce.
Yeah, that's right.
I have to keep my thinking on one thing.
Yes, Jesus. Yes, yes, yes.
Because whatever's coming out of your mind, whatever's coming out of your renewed mind, whatever's coming out of your saved mind, you're going to produce it.
That's right. Amen. Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
And your mind is in forward motion because your mind is in creative motion going forward.
Yes. If it's negative, well then you're going to create negative.
Yeah, whatever's in your mind, you will create lust. If you lust, you will fall. Whatever's in your mind, you're going to be it.
Gird up your loins.
Our heart must be reassured that His Spirit is still in covenant with us. What He's called us to do, He will do. Let my people go. This is the heart cry of the Father for the glorious church. World, let my people go. Pain, let my people go. Depression, let my people go. Sickness, let my people go. Poverty, let my people go. This is the heart cry of the Father. God's heart and vision is a vast company of sons, the many-membered body of Christ. The body is His permanent abode. Each member released by the living word and a global shaking to make full proof of His ministry. The day of shaking is upon us all. God has sent a man to shake the political parties of the United States of America. Pray that those handlers don't get a hold of him and try to make him like one of them.
Yes.
And the same thing with Ted Cruz. Yes. We know who I was talking about.
Yeah.
That Ted Cruz is a constitutionalist. He's a man of God. He's a man of the word. Amen. Pray that his handlers do not turn him into one of them.
Amen.
Why are they telling him that? So that he will be more, they will be more politically correct, so they can get the unpolitically correct to vote for them. We don't need to appease those who are not politically correct. We need to convert them into the mind of Christ. That they will have the mind of Christ, and that we will put this nation back under God.
Yes. Amen.
Now we know we had this situation with Target. How much time I got here? Do I have time to? I don't have much time. I'm very sorry. Don't worry about it. Okay, I don't know what time we have to be on. But y'all may see what I posted on Facebook about this Target thing. And I'm going to tell you, I will do it. So Sonya said she was going to start saving mail money. So I don't know.
You always say no.
If I see a transgender in the restroom with me, I will absolutely knock him in the head in my face. I will grab his ear and I will pull him out of there and I will tell him that it's no place for him to be hurt. And that should be the attitude of every American.
It should, amen.
Send him his own bathroom.
So Target's letting them do it basically.
You know, Roger Till was a little plain spoken when he was here the last time, but you know, prophets tend to be plain spoken. It's simple.
Yeah,
right. Figure out what you are and be it.
Did you hear Kirk Schilling spoke out against that this week? Got fired.
Yeah, y'all want to fire me?
Okay.
Y'all can't fire me. Praise God. I got through this time. But the earth will have its jubilee, its captives rescued from the prison house. All creation is ready for release.
Yes.
Standing on tiptoe, waiting for the sons of God to come into their own.
That's right.
Yes.
Everything's waiting on us.
Yes.
Everything is shifting into higher gear. Did I tell you about my week last week? Everything is shifting into higher gear.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We got to speed up. We can't slow down.
Amen.
This global eruption will prove and declare the quality of every man's work. Every sealed house must pass through the refiner's fire.
Mm.
Casual tremors, earthquakes this week. Floods. Wasn't this a historical flood for Houston? We're still flooding.
Biblical
proportions. These greater shakings have begun. And one of the scripture in Job says, Joanne, I thought about using that, but I didn't. I was careful. Thursday night, that when the floods come, that which is hidden shall be uncovered. And we had
that's right.
And we had just done that. Listen to what had been done. I just want you to know I used restraint. But the Apostle Peter.
I'm sure those Baptists can answer.
The Apostle Peter predicted a universal convulsion in the last chapter of his second epistle, divulging three worlds: the world that was, the world kept in store until now, and the world wherein dwells righteousness. The Greek word for world is cosmos and means an order, system, or arrangement of things. The cosmos is a mindset, a mentality, a way of thinking, and its consequent lifestyle. The cosmos, the world system, is presently running our nation. Satan is the prince of that world. The first world was Noah's cosmos. God destroyed that order, not the earth. God did not destroy the earth, he destroyed the order with water. In spiritual realities, God consumed our old man, the world that then was in the waters of baptism. The second world exists from that time until now, reserved unto fire. His word, our voice, in the mouth of his prophets. If in the midst of this shaking, If the church will not become the voice of God with fire to agree with this shaking, God will raise up donkeys to speak for him.
Come on.
Our cattle.
That's right.
That's good.
The elements that melt with fervent heat are the beggarly elements, the rudimentary concepts and principles of man-made tradition. I've had all that stuff burned off me before. Sometimes you can get baggage on you, but listen, let me tell you, once you get it burned off of you, you don't need it anymore.
Amen. Right.
The third world is the immovable kingdom of God, whose government and peace is marked by endless increase. Endless increase. There is no ending in the kingdom of God. It is eternal in the heavens. When your mind gets in the place where you are producing kingdom principles, you're forever moving forward. There is
That's
no
right.
behind.
That's right.
It's moving
That's
forward,
right.
creating
Appreciate
endless
it.
Creation
right.
you have connected with.
That's right.
Thank
Amen.
You, God.
Thank you. How do you beat this into other Christians' head?
tell them to come to church.
Come to church.
They come here, they're going to hear it. Haggai 12:25-28. It's Hebrews. Hebrews quotes Haggai. I'm using Hebrews here. See that you do not refuse him that speaks. I can't tell you how many times I'm smarter than I look. You this, and they'll smile and thank me, and they will go on and do what they intended to do in the first place.
Exactly.
Yeah.
See that you do not refuse him that speaks. For if they escape not who refused him that spoke on earth, this is Hebrews, this is New Testament talking about Jesus, much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaks from heaven. Talking about the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Whose voice then shook the earth, but now he has promised, saying, yet once more, not 10 times more, once more, I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. And this word, yet once more, signifies the removing of those things that are shaken, as of the things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. If you've ever been through a shaking of God, you know what that means. And you know whatever you got left with you is glad to see that other stuff go.
Right.
We who are in the kingdom of God will live in unshakable peace in this time of global shaking. Do not be afraid. Do not have fear. The place he brought you out to take you in.
Amen.
He brought you out to take you in.
That's right.
And what God takes us into is so much more awesome than anything he brought us
Come
out.
Come on now, amen.
Throughout the nation and the world, everything is being shaken. God is sifting out everything without solid foundations. The shaking of heaven and earth signifies or makes clear the removing of those things that can be shaken. The word for voice in Hebrews is phone, phone. It means noise, sound, voice. A voice that men can hear and see. If you get a dream and you've got a telephone call in it, that dream means that you just got a message from heaven. That was a straight line message from heaven. Hebrews 12:29. Wherefore we receiving a kingdom which cannot be shaken, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear, for our God is a consuming fire.
Amen.
This global shift is a moving experience from earth to heaven, from joy to sorrow, from darkness to light, and from death to life. We're jarred out of the temporal into the eternal, out of the passing into the permanent, out of the appearance, our circumstances, into faith. Things that cannot be moved will remain or abide. And those things which are not of God will be gone.
Amen.
Hebrews 2:6. For thus says the Lord of hosts, yet once it is a little while, and I will shake the heavens and the earth and the sea and the dry land. Global shaking has begun. Out of control climate changes. They're in a total tither, worshiping the God of global warming. His name is Baal.
Yes.
Floods, hurricanes, droughts, fires, earthquakes, and volcanoes are the travail of natural creation. The birth pangs of a new day. God will fill the earth with himself. God will shake the nations as he did Egypt with the rod of Moses. The Father's ultimate intention, the mystery of his will, captures the essence of the high priestly prayer of John 17 and the apostolic aim of Ephesians 4. The unity of the Spirit is to become the unity of the faith. This is my scripture. I print it on everything that I do. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. That's my calling. Unity cannot be created. Have you ever tried to create unity? Have you ever worked on doing fixing that? It can only be kept. Mm-hmm. All unity flows from the union between the Father and the Son. And it's based upon the seven absolutes of Ephesians 4 through 4 through 6. One body, one spirit, one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all. Amen. The shaking of the heavens and earth will resurrect his army and release all things into one. Haggai's shaking recalls the Exodus, the humbling of proud Egypt by the 10 plagues. The destruction of Pharaoh's army in the Red Sea are described as the shaking. This quake begins in the heavens and echoes in the earth, from heaven to earth, from spiritual to natural, from God to man. The overturning of all nations is just defined in Haggai 2:22 as the complete overthrow and destruction of the throne and strength of all heathen kingdoms. So I posted on Facebook last night that someone, I think it was Rodney Howard Brown, someone said that Donald Trump was overthrowing basically the Illuminati, but the one world government order. It will be overthrown. That he is not a member of one world government order. And that he is overthrowing it. I think Rodney Howard Brown posted that. I'm not saying, I'm just telling y'all what I read. Okay. God rocks the heavens, the earth, the sea, and finally the dry land or desert. The Bible clearly defines the dry land to be rebellion and wickedness. Habakkuk 2:7. I will shake all nations, and the desire of all nations shall come, and I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord of hosts. I'm going to get into glory, baby, next week, too. I'm telling you, I just got carried away last night, didn't I? Okay.
You go, girl.
I got going.
We're here.
Following Haggai's era, Jehovah shook Persia, Greece, and Rome. In recent years, he has shaken the communist nations, the Arab nations, and our own nation. This shaking of all nations has a singular result. The desire of all nations shall come. That reading to you from Haggai. The result of this is that the desire of all nations will come. The desire of all nations is the Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. This also includes the body in union with him, his bride. Together with Christ in the fullness of his body, they shall come. God's desire, the desire of God's heart, is for Christ to be fully formed in his people.
Amen.
Haggai 2:9 denotes his elect out of all nations, whom he calls, justifies, and glorifies, Christ in among all of us, and the hope of glory.
Amen.
The glory of this latter house shall be greater than of the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place will I give peace, says the Lord of hosts. The Lord of hosts, Carolyn, I don't know if you saw my notes, but you had a song this morning about Kabosh, the Lord of hosts. I said, oh Lord, right there, my message. The Lord of hosts is the Lord of the armies of heaven and earth. He's named 14 times by Haggai, 53 times by Zechariah, and 24 times by Malachi. This divine name appears over 300 times, mostly in the prophetic books. These heavenly armies were symbolized by the golden cherubim that covered the Ark of the Covenant, between which the Lord of hosts was enthroned. Father God asks, where is my house? Where is my army? And where is your desire for my vision and heart? There are two New Testament words for temple. Hebron, physical temple in Jerusalem, and Naos, spiritual temple of Jesus and his church. Naos, the spiritual building, the real temple pertaining to the Lord Jesus Christ, his body, the church, the inner sanctuary. In him dwells all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Second, Naos refers to the temple of God, the church. This is the house, the people, the spiritual family that Father God desires to assemble, restore, and fill with his glory and unending peace. Unending peace. Whatever sorrow, whatever hurt, whatever pain, whatever trouble that you have, in the midst of all of the shaking that's going on in your life, whatever it is that God has brought you out of your own world in Egypt, are these things that have a hold on you? Whatever has a hold on you to cause you pain, you worship it. Hey, God constantly challenges us to be involved with the work that contains God's desire. The first step in that direction is to understand that the finished temple is an undivided heart, completely devoted to the Lord. An undivided heart, where that our spirit then is completely devoted to the Lord. Are we there yet? No, but we're on our way. We're on our way. The shaking of Haggai 2:7 is the birth pains of the womb of the morning. These deliverers, an overcoming man-child company and son, shall be caught up to the place of God's authority. Our timeless God already sees all of us from first to last as having come. The book of Revelation, the unveiling of the slain lamb, presents his brethren as one new man. He that overcomes. Not they that overcome. Not those who barely overcome. Not those who are striving to overcome. But that one new man that God is bringing forth, which will be his body, his church within him, that one new man that the body speaks of is he that overcomes.
Woo! Come on now. Yes, Lord.
So we'll continue on this next week. I just barely got started.
Man.
As you know, we've been talking before that the time of God's shaking. And God is just, you know, as we continued on and through this, because I've been, you know, I've walked this way many times. God's brought me through some stuff. He shook a lot off of me through the years. But I know when he brings us out of something, he's taking us in. And church, he's not going to just leave us out there wandering around. He is going to take us in. And where he's taking the church to in this hour is far better than anything that you and I have ever seen. Look how great the charismatic revival was. We're still feasting off of that. Yeah. Look how great Pentecost was. We're still feasting off of Pentecost. And he's taking us into another realm. And in that realm, it is going to be so glorious that the glory of the church, it is going to be on you and in you and wherever you walk. God's going to give you authority over where you walk. God's going to give you authority over every area of your life. It's going to be, next week we're going to get in the silver and the gold. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. I sped that up a little bit. I probably put a little too much in there. I got carried away.
Yeah.